Dr. Ma, it is my
Hi.
First time to meet you.
Yes, how are you? Thank you so much for the invitation.
It's an honor for us to see you, to share together with you today.
Thank you. Likewise. And please call me Maha.
Maha. Okay,
yes.
Thank you.
There you go.
Yeah. Remember. Thank you. We have Mrs. Dr. Alice Lee, who is watching us now. Okay, I think that it is time to begin, but as we are waiting for those people,
Professor Agboke.
Professor right. Agboke is holding now a meeting for his department, but he told me that he will be here. I think that he will join us in some minutes.
Right.
Yeah. Great. So we can begin before, after he will join us.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much, everyone. I am very happy today. Professor Felipe Chiba Ortiz, the co-leader of Ground and Town Mile City, and I welcome you to our monthly Building Latin America, Caribe, Africa, and Canada Mile City meeting. Since 2020, we are working on this topic in Africa and Quebec. And today, it is an honor for us to welcome our guest, Ms. Rachel Fischer, Dr. Ma, Dr. Veronica, and Dr. Alice, who is watching us now. And today, our topic focus on MIL University Cities expansion strategies in Africa. Before we go through the topic, I will let Professor Felipe to welcome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, dear friend and partner, Professor Emmanuel Komi Konako. I am really happy to be here with these experts and partners too. Rachel Fischer is a special guest today, and she is a friend. Is a friend too, friend and partner. we write articles together and many other things. It's my pleasure to receive today and share this space with a professor, Dr. Veronica Yarnik. She is an expert of UNESCO too and co-leader with me of the initiative MIL Cities and co-leader too the group innovation group from UNESCO. of course, to receive the Professor Dr. Maha Basri. Maha Basri is too a good friend and partner and fighter. she fight together in other space too. I feel really, really happy because the women are present here in this MIL Cities webinar. This is very important to us, for me and the professor, Dr. Emmanuel Komi Konako. We are really happy for the presence of everyone and you, of course. And I for me, it's important too, the presence in the public for the Alice, our partner, Alice Lee. From Hong Kong, we fight for the unity. We fight for the peace, and it's very important. The vision of the different countries, different cities, different forms for visions of the cities in the different continents. This is very, this point is very, very important. And we have here a person, special persons. Everyone are for me and for everybody, in my opinion, too. The topic today is very important. MIL University Cities. MIL University Cities is a transformation or modification or application, better application, of the framework of UNESCO MIL Cities. MIL Cities is a general framework, but we have applications or forms to implementation of this framework in the universities, in the campi of the universities of the world. We, in this session, can hear different visions, different highlights, ideas, opinions about this. This point, I repeat, is very important and necessary for the transformation of the universities now. We have in this moment, in this time, many challenges. For example, we have the challenge to the digital transformation. We have the challenge of the pandemic. We have many challenges, but we need frameworks, concepts to for this transformation. But this transformation with ethics, and with a vision. In my opinion, the vision, the more important vision at this moment, is MIL Cities and MIL University Cities. MIL University Cities can be a light for the transformation of the universities in Africa. Well, our dear friend and excellent fighter and professor, of course, too, Rachel Fischer, speak today about strategics for this. But now, dear Professor Komi Konako, let's get the war, get the flow, our guest, please.
Thank you, Professor Felipe, for your addressing word. It is a very great moment for us to hear Professor Rachel from South Africa. You have the floor. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that beautiful introduction, situating the context in general of MIL Cities concept, as well as then in particular, the MIL University Cities concept. Before I start, I wish to emphasize once again the shared vision of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights towards equality, freedom, and peace across all nations, whether it is in a continent or in a global perspective. But let us stand together, not only as brothers, sisters, colleagues, and fellows, towards achieving these goals and principles set out within the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, supported by the United Nations, as well as UNESCO, of which within this presentation is situated. So let us consider, in terms of MIL Cities and the universities, certainly, as Felipe has indicated, that no society remains untouched by information and communication technologies. It is essential then that we do use digital opportunities to shift us and enable us towards achieving such connectivity. Unfortunately, as in many other regions in the world, Africa and the countries within Africa are still struggling with the last mile or the last kilometer connection and rollout of these technologies. something that should be seen as a basic human right, such as access to the internet and to the global networks, still is not accessible to many of the citizens and populations of Africa. And that is concerning when we have gaps within such communities and in communication supported by ICTs. We see how the digital divide just gets bigger, together with falling behind in the development, going from an information society towards a knowledge society, and ultimately even an artificial intelligence society. This widening digital divide inevitably contributes to information poverty, which we all already know is a social injustice. And that is why it is our social responsibility as researchers and academics to fight and raise awareness on these issues. That is why University MIL Cities are so important, because universities ought to be positioned in a place within the ecosystem of these cities where they not only collaborate and interact from a top-down level, but also bottom-up. There should be strong collaboration with government, intergovernmental organizations, civil society organizations, as well as with grassroots communities. University ought not to be an inaccessible ivory tower, but a forefront champion of rights, education, and accessibility. This presentation then ultimately shows how such a collaboration can be achieved by using the Future Africa Institute at the University of Pretoria as a local example, but then also indicating how an international example, such as the International Center for Information Ethics, contributes to this vision. So we have the absolute experts in MIL Cities within this session. It hardly requires any introduction when we look at the importance of MIL University Cities and what they consist of. But just to make sure that we are all cognizant of these elements is to see how University Cities is a derivation of the MIL City framework as supported by UNESCO. We also see how various curricula on information ethics, media and information literacy should be integrated and articulated across all university courses. For example, not just in communication studies, but across all faculties in education, IT, engineering, architecture, etc., due to the ecosystem that we experience in these communities. Community engagement must be used as a platform for thought development in higher education institutions. But it's also very important that when we look at communication and community engagement, is that we consider notions of cultural diversity and sensitivity towards such inclusivity. Universities, as already indicated, play a very important role within this ecosystem, and they should ensure that they contribute towards the development of MIL Cities, albeit with government collaboration, once again, civil society, as well as the private sector, which in many cases do contribute to the support and funding structures. It is very important then that we ensure then to teach the principles of information ethics and MIL so that we could understand the full impact of culture, cultural barriers, and intercultural communication to understand various human behaviors within these contexts. It is very difficult to engage and include these communities if we're not sensitive and open up dialogues for collaboration. So this is so important because as we are looking at fourth industrial revolution and ICT integration, that ICTs, robots and AI are not the ones that are giving the color and diversity to our cities and to our countries and our continents, but it's human beings. And human beings have got values, feelings, emotions, and they ought to be supported and promoted. And that's where these cities can play such an important role. We have previously engaged with the metrics. These are the 13 very important metrics as developed by Professor Felipe Chibas and Professor Yanaze, that continue publishing on this, Professor Emmanuel Kumiko, Dr. Veronica Yanak. I'll be very glad to share information, but this is a brief overview of what the city metrics consist of. But once again, it's very important to highlight how almost no aspect of society is excluded within these city metrics, whether it goes from libraries to urban planning to cultural heritage, aspects of security, environment and sustainability, and the inclusion of gender, LGBTQ+, and other groups, as well as language, cultural, minority groups, and the promotion of indigenous knowledge systems. So why should we expand the small university concept in Africa? Expansion is embedded in networks, objects, programs across so many entities. UNESCO is so global in scope, with national commissions in all of the member states, and it consists of various subsectors, whether it's in education, science, culture, and communication information sector. But not only do we have these global entities, we also have regional frameworks such as the AU Agenda for 2063, as well as in South Africa, the National Development Plan of 2030, as well as then globally, the Sustainable Development Goals of 2030. So if we look at a South African example, this national framework, as well as the global framework of the Sustainable Development Goals, we are already within a decade for change. We've got 8 years towards achieving these goals, and I'm not that certain that we are very close to achieving those. There are efforts, but we could only achieve this by such collaboration. It's therefore essential that we allow for mutual recognition, collaboration, and reciprocity from these global international entities to local and regional representatives, so that we ensure a top-down and a bottom-up approach and avoid socio-political and economic hegemonies, as is sometimes often the case in Northern Hemisphere or the Global North campaigns. I don't want to say rhetoric, but in terms of policy development, technological development, that in some instances stifle the voices and knowledge systems of global South entities and other marginalized societies. So if we're looking at a proposed African network expansion strategy, which is also applicable to all the regions across the globe, is to ensure that this is a meeting point, as we are having right now, having a global meeting point of diverse stakeholders to continue contributing to these pools of expertise towards consolidating existing knowledge as a basis. And please ensure that when I do refer to knowledge, knowledge in general, like epistemology or episteme, but very importantly, indigenous knowledge systems. It must be an avenue of transfer and expertise going from the various levels, international, regional, local, as well as local, regional to national, which underscores the importance of dealing and working with our communities, but also the UNESCO national commissions in our countries, the regional offices of UNESCO, and inadvertently reporting to the headquarters, so that it is very visible to see what we are doing on the ground. Let's consolidate sectoral plans and programs. In many instances, we do spend so much funds in developing a new program or developing a new strategy, which only contributes to repetition and wasting so much money, whereas we should be on the ground, active and responsive to the needs. So if we benchmark notions of success, focus on the needs of country and local communities, and then the MIL University Cities priorities, we should foster such international collaboration. And then once again, I wish to underscore to engage internationally, to regionally, locally, and then vice versa, to ensure we continue with this ecosystem. A local or an international approach, and an example is the International Center for Information Ethics. And what the International Center seeks to do is to look at the current parameters of the field of information ethics. So not just looking at access or intellectual property and trying to stay away from plagiarism, but also looking at how information ethics underscores social justice, social responsibility, attempts to cross the digital divide, attempts to improve and seek to amend instances of information poverty, and also to support MIL University cities. We seek to establish foundational partnerships dealing with the Latin American Caribbean regions, the India subcontinent, as well as other regions across the globe to ensure we've got a South-South dialogue and North-South dialogues taking place. Not only do we engage in these activities, but we also want to publish on them regularly so as to contribute with the creative and open commons platform's awareness of such projects. You can see here a very rapidly changing taxonomy of information ethics and also by extension media and information literacy. But the aim now is not necessarily to go into detail. But as we can see, due to COVID, where we all had to also migrate to virtual spaces, information ethics and MIL are essentially integrated across all elements of society. Future Africa Institute at the University of Pretoria is an example of a Pan-African institute. So whereas a university focuses on their own output and their engagements with local communities and government, they still need to prioritize, promote, and empower their vision as a university, looking at metrics, you know those global rankings of where universities are. And they're in competition looking to see what's the academic outputs and publications and how many books are going out and conferences are being organized and attended, which is good for knowledge development. But this competition does not always contribute to sustainable creation, sharing, and collaborative efforts. That is why Future Africa is Pan-Africa. It's not just about the University of Pretoria, within Pretoria, within South Africa. It's a Pan-African vision and site for collaboration. Future Africa has a number of research themes, 6 to be specific, and they're very similar to the MIL Cities metrics that we've looked at earlier. We could see how the theme seeks to connect Africa, looking at the people of Africa through shared diverse histories, unique cultures, indigenous knowledge systems, and looking at new opportunities offered by technology. Another theme is from African soil, so to promote, empower, and create awareness of knowledge from African production systems, whether it's on climate, land, agriculture, and biodiversity, to looking at promoting fellowships within regions, but also seeing how we empower the youth and contribute to MIL University cities from Africa for Africans. It's very important to look at the importance of health, not only medical health, but the people and the places in which they are and move. So local communities are essential here, and in many cases, they don't have access to the latest medical technology, medicines, vaccinations, etc. So how do we afford opportunities for access of these communities? But what can we learn from their own local indigenous knowledge and traditional medicines? Looking at the future of education and future opportunities, which is supported by collaboration with entities such as UNESCO and UNICEF, to make sure that we don't forget those left out with digital migration that are missing out on education opportunities. Equity in a global Africa is very important, where economic development should not just be limited to countries that have higher GDPs than others, but to ensure we've got pathways for collaboration towards policy, governance, and social innovation, which is why a shared objective towards attaining the goals of the African Union Agenda of 2063 is so important. And then finally, sustainability science. Whatever it is that we do is to ensure that we remain sustainable, to respect and acknowledge local communities without having long-term ecological and social systemic impacts on these communities. As you can see, perhaps in my background, it is displayed the campus of Future Africa. All the water networks, all the buildings are green, sustainable, architecturally developed buildings that work together with the environment for natural heating and cooling systems. All the plants are edible. Well, all plants are edible, I suppose, but they've got very high nutritional worth. They can be used, eaten by the residents living on this campus and visitors. And we've got a plant called a spekboom, which is one of the plants similar to the snake plant. But the spekboom is one of the plants with the highest CTO, carbon dioxide to oxygen transference plants. So the campus is covered by them. So not only looking at technology and education as being sustainable, but actually looking at our environments that should be sustainable as well. Here are our principles once again towards developing collaboration, teamwork, being Africa focused and supporting diversity and open science through forward-looking leadership. We do so by promoting transdisciplinarity. And this is an instance of information ethics and media and information literacy, because transdisciplinarity cuts across all disciplines. It's not limited to only one discipline. It does not seek to be exclusive. It rather wants to be inclusive and open for collaboration to learn from other entities so we can constantly improve and promote various forms of literacies. Even media and information literacy is not just regarding media. It looks at all forms of information and all forms of ICT developments, even AI literacies. And with the growth and expansion of emerging technologies, we need to be able to keep updated with what is happening. I've referred a number of times to the African Union Agenda of 2063. But three goals here are specifically important if we look at more university cities expansion. And this is to ensure with goal one, or priority area one, is a prosperous Africa based on inclusive growth and sustainable development. And here we see goal two, which promotes well-educated citizens and the skills revolution, once again, by achieving last mile rollout of ICT networks and broadband connectivity. We only achieve this through education and science and technology innovation revolution plans. Priority area number three is an Africa of good governance, democracy, respect for human rights, justice, and the rule of law. And there are three goals that need to be observed. Goal 11 is democratic values, practices, and universal principles of human rights to ensure democracy, good governance, human rights, and justices are observed, promoted, and I don't want to say enforced, that's the wrong word, but to ensure that we protect those communities that don't have these rights and freedoms associated. Goal two is capable institutions and the transformation leadership that should be in place. Here we can see where MIL university cities are so important, because if we are looking at universities situated within a local context, and our social responsibility with local communities and engagement with collaborative efforts, not just as an institute looking to see how much they can publish, we achieve being a capable MIL university city institution. And all of this contributes to goal three, promoting peace, security, and stability that should be preserved and promoted. And then finally, priority area number six is an Africa whose development in people is driven by people, relying on the potential offered by African people, its women and the youth, and caring for children. Africa has got the highest youth population in the globe, which means in 10, 20 years from now, they will be the predominant workforce in the global stage. Especially if we are looking at some Eastern countries and European countries who are a very aging population and a negative population growth. So how do we prioritize MIL cities and education and literacy in Africa to make sure we have an informed and a supported population that could lead the next generation of youth? And this we do by ensuring gender parity and equality according to Goal 17, as well as engaged empowerment of youth and gender. So here we should consider looking at children's rights with our eyes to the future, not just the current situation. So finally, it is very evident for us when evaluating MIL cities, we must consider the cultural context in which it is situated, something that is only achieved by looking at cultural barriers, barriers with intercultural communication, barriers in terms of education opportunities, whether it's online, virtual, offline, in real life, as our traditional education spaces, and to see how information poverty is exacerbated by such digital divides. It is important, once again, to look at the needs of local communities, to fight against hegemonic structures that only seek to push down from a top-down approach, rather to promote bottom-up. So we do require information and information literacy training, but we can only achieve this as a MIL university city in collaboration and associations with trade unions, non-governmental organizations, social cultural projects, and other non-traditional actors as aligned with these frameworks. I thank you for listening and your patience. And if there are any questions or items that require clarity or that might have led to uncertainty, please don't hesitate to put them in the question and answer or in the chat. I thank you.
Wow. Thank you, Miss Rachel, for your excellent speech. It is very, very interesting. So I will let the floor to Professor Felipe and others to add, to ask, you a question or to contribute. Thank you very much.
Thank you, thank you so much, dear Emmanuel. Congratulations, Rachel. Your lecture was wonderful. In my opinion, I invite you to publish this lecture like a chapter in another book. We prepared another book about MIL cities, MIL city universities, or MIL cities. And your speech is excellent for that. That's the first point. I like so much your presentation. For example, the metrics and indicators, 13 metrics and indicators, is the base of the transformation of the campi of the universities in MIL city universities. This point is very important. It's the base for everything. The examples, I like so much your talk about Pretoria University. We want to know this university, of course. I like so much your vision, Pan-African vision. This point is very important too. The base of this develop, this the thing. The different countries in Africa are different sunshines, different cultures. Africa, and South Africa too, is a multicultural place, and the barriers, cultural barriers to communication, is very important topic for Africa, for other continents too, but for Africa especially. I like so much your vision too in this way. What I like so much the in general of your presentation, the principles are very clear in your presentation. But please, other speakers, your opinions are important too, please.
Okay, please, before this, I will let you know that Professor Agboubli joined us.
Oh, right.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Yeah, the staff, you have the floor.
Oh, Professor Dr. Veronica. or Professor Dr. Mahabhasri. We need your opinions.
If possible, I would like to focus your attention on two samples, simply two samples, without any presentation. The first I would like to say that there was absolutely wonderful presentation from Rachel, and I would like to say that it's very interesting, the sample of the university, Future Africa, am I right? So as an interdisciplinary or multidisciplinary approach, of course. I would like to focus the idea of MIL University City, or the place of the university in the MIL City, simply from another side. I would like to share with you the samples of some European towns, for example, Olomouc in Czech Republic, where the university is the center of the town, simply the center of the town. So all life of the town is around the university, Palatsky. Also, I would like to highlight the ideas of Cambridge and Oxford, which are the centers of the city. And there is the center of not only the life in the city, but of course the educational hub. And I would like to highlight the idea of inside the MIL University City. So I would like to highlight the idea of informational and media literate hub, or educational hub. So the university, it's the hub of all informational flows, educational flows, and sharing them knowledge. And my second sample is about the Coursera. And for example, the course about digital literacy in Coursera from the High School of Economy. There is one of our university in Moscow. And I would like to underline that this course is not only for the students. It's open for everybody. So this course about media and digital literacy is in the pool of the free of charge courses in Coursera. So every person can take it and increase the level of the person's personal digital literacy. So I would like to pay your attention on these two examples. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Veronica, for your contribution. It is very interesting. So now we can give the floor to Dr. Mahabhasri. Yeah, thank you. You are welcome.
Rachel, thank you so much for the presentation. You really give us a lot of hope as Africans, because usually the news coming out of the continent does not seem to be very positive. But in this case, there is an agenda, there is a plan. I am really, really excited to see that Indigenous knowledge is included in the plan, because media, communication, media literacy is all contextual at the end of the day. We need to service the societies in which it exists. And obviously our African context is very different than other contexts, that's one. The second point is, as you mentioned, we in Africa usually tend to be lumped, I think Felipe actually alluded to this, into one group. We are many groups, we come together and we form the continent of Africa. Yes. I'm really, really happy that it's interdisciplinary. The only thing, and I just wanna see what your take is on that. It's a very positive, very forward agenda. But in my opinion, and again, from the research, the idea of social justice, social and political stability are very important if you want to create these hubs of knowledge, if you want to collate knowledge, existing knowledge with new, the information society. And there is no doubt, looking at our context in Africa, that we tend to have a lot of instability. So how do we overcome this? And how do we overcome the social injustices? There's a lot of disparity between the groups, especially when it comes to gender, when it comes to minority groups across the continent. How do we overcome this? And I'll give a tangible example. If we look at Sudan now, for example, we have a revolution that's been going on for the past 2-3 years. The university, the hub of all knowledge, all universities have been closed on and off for the past 4 months, 5 months now. So how do we ensure continuity? How do we ensure that we have a transfer of knowledge if we don't have stability? And I don't think that Sudan is, you know, a unique case. We have that happening in Mali. We have that happening in Ethiopia. We have that happening across the entire, you know, continent. So in your opinion and in your plan, how can we address this issue, which is fundamental if we want to proceed?
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Emmanuel, may I respond on the answers?
You have the floor to answer.
Thank you so much. Okay, so first of all, thank you for your compliments, Felipe. And certainly with the book, I know that you're always on the forefront of keeping up with your publications and your book and making them accessible on this item. And to capture these presentations, I know you are very busy with the MIL Africa agenda as well in collaboration with others. It would be good to have a MIL University or a MIL Cities Africa edition, perhaps, knowing that you've got your access to global networks. So if we could negotiate on that point, having an Africa focus, I definitely will contribute. So let's keep that line open. Then to Veronica, thank you so much for giving those examples. And I'm going to connect your examples with what Maha brought to the front. Now, the University of Pretoria is also situated within the city of Pretoria. I mean, all capitals are large, and it's in the central. It's not the only university. We also have the Tshwane University of Technology, and we also have the University of South Africa, UNISA, which is the largest distance learning university, if I'm not mistaken, in the Southern Hemisphere, but at least in Africa. So we've got so many university hubs and then other education institutes, of course, in the city. Interestingly enough, and because my example is Future Africa, we are situated what is known as the experiential farm. You drive into these grounds and you think that you're in the farmland somewhere. You're surrounded by orchids, you're surrounded by cows, you're surrounded by fields, which is where the students in agriculture and the students in forestry and biodiversity and the veterinary students and others come for their research, looking at going back into communities, looking at climate, land, agriculture, and biodiversity. So in this instance, this institute is situated in a space that addresses the food security needs and sustainability that is required also in Africa and globally if we're looking at climate change and COP26. So in this instance, it's not a hub as when we imagine how Oxford looks like or Harvard looks like or Cambridge looks like. This is on a farm, which I think is quite exciting and novel. And like I said, you know, here we've got solar panels, we are circulating water systems, we've got plants being utilized. So the environment and the ecosystem adjust to the needs of the community, similar as other university cities do. Now, Maha, to come to your question, and allow me then to divert from our terminology of media and information literacy and information ethics. I seek to acknowledge, like you say, these terms are contextual. Now, if we look at social responsibility, information poverty, there are a number of items that we deal with. So you get a justice of distribution, so the distribution of needs, goods, and information according to the needs of people and communities. But also have issues of justice of contribution. This is where the knowledge systems come in. We're looking at the indigenous contributions to global exchanges, not just the North, but global South. We have development, we're looking at participation, enabling those communities, etc. Now you asked, you know, how do we ensure that we do what is just and what is needed, looking at our various complexities and challenges faced across Africa and the sustainability between these communities, dealing with whether it's economic, political, or societal disruptions, which is so true. And with COVID as an example, but political instability as well. The University of Pretoria also faced numerous protests where campuses were closed for weeks at end. And those are realities, and you cannot stop education because of that. What I want to refer to as examples of this institute, which has got its seeds of vision and opportunity and hope, as you said, is CLAB, or Future Africa, has got a number of projects that I alluded to on climate change. We call it CLAB, so climate, land, agriculture, and biodiversity. But we also have a project that is looking at youth empowerment and health systems and education facing or issues that came up with COVID. There's another project that looks at developing fellowship programs for recipients in African countries in the different regions, in ECOWAS, COMESA, and SADC specifically, not at this point the Central Africa region or Northern Africa region. Now, why these projects are important are that they're attracting funders such as UNICEF, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the Carnegie Corporation of New York, together with other funders from the tech sector like Microsoft, but also local funding from government. And they are seeing these new opportunities that the Pan-African transdisciplinarity vision is contributing because it's not siloist in nature. Now, certainly we need to attend to the objectives that these organizations have because, I mean, they're funding and we need to attend to their funding. But in all of the projects that we've submitted, they want to see community impact and community engagement. So the fellows acquire funding and support, not just to be in South Africa, actually not, but for enabling research in their local communities, whether it's in Uganda, Kenya, Ghana, Benin. And those are constantly fostered. So we're looking at an expansion network, currently more than 600 individuals in the African continent, and hopefully continues growing, because these projects don't remain isolated in time and space. We continue to spread them throughout the African network. So that for me is a very long answer to your precise question, is that in this endeavor of ours, if we get attention from global partners, Global North funders that are focusing on the needs of these local communities, we already have those channels for communication. And they don't want just research and academic output. They want local community engagement and looking at indigenous knowledge systems to be produced or produced on the global stage. And that makes me excited.
Wow. It makes all of us excited. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So please look at the website link that I shared, on Future Africa. You'll see all the projects happening.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Marat, Dr. Rachel. We have here Dr. Professor Ayauvi Agbuke. I don't know if you can add something before we end this meeting. Dr. Agbuke, Professor Agbuke, you are in mute.
Hey, hello. Bonsoir to the panelists.
Hello, everybody. Hello.
Fine. Good evening, every panelist. Alors, je voulais m'excuser un peu. J'étais venu prendre la communication en cours de route.
I would like to apologize to you because I am late.
Et j'ai suivi la fin. J'ai été vraiment émerveillé par la communication de Rachel.
I follow everything and I hear everything and I am very, very interested. I want to, congratulate Dr. Rachel for what she has shared with us.
Et je crois que tout ce qu'elle a dit, si on peut vraiment l'appliquer dans les universités africaines, je pense que le MCC va avancer, va gagner tout le monde entier.
And I hope that if we can implement what she has shared with us today in every country, in every university in Africa, my university cities will be very strong.
OK. D'accord. Je vous remercie. Sinon, nous aussi, déjà, on a eu à organiser des activités dans ce sens. Les OSG qu'on a, Pafeme.
OK. As you, I will let you know that we have organized some meeting in our universities together with Pafeme and other non-government organizations in Togo.
Et c'était déjà en janvier 2019. Donc, on a pris vraiment la chose au sérieux.
In January 2019, we have had our first meeting in our university to talk about MIL university cities, but in not in this particular topic.
Et je crois que avec ça, avec les activités qu'on va programmer, je crois que d'ici peu, on va essayer de programmer d'autres colloques dans ce sens.
OK. And I hope that,
à l'université de Lomé.
I hope that in the future, near future, you organize other meeting in University of Lomé to share the project, to share the initiative we are talking about today.
Okay, je vous remercie.
Okay, I thank you. Pardon me, I'm a Frenchman, so I try to speak English. So
very good.
Thank you.
So good. Your translation are very good. Don't worry, man.
Professor, okay. I love it.
I understand everything.
Yeah,
I understand everything. Okay. And your translation are very clear. No problem at all.
Thank you. Okay. Is there any question, contribution, suggestion? Okay. I think we are at the end of this meeting, and I will let Professor Felipe and everyone here to say one thing to which we can share with the world about MIL university cities, even though in Africa, in the world, in the whole world, right. It is a challenge for everyone. It is a challenge for every researcher. It is a challenge for every director, even citizen, to know that today, if we don't develop, implement MIL in our communities, in our school, in our home, we will have problem. Because today, we will never be separated from screen, from technology. And everyone knows to know how to learn what he can do with technology ethically. So, Rachel, you will be invited for the third to share with us what you know about ethics in MIL cities. Thank you. You have the floor, Professor.
Thank you so much. In my opinion, this is very, very important meeting. In other times, we have other webinars, very important webinars. But this webinar is a base or the very important point, focus point for many others. Congratulations, Rachel Fischer. Congratulations, Veronica Jarnik, Maha Basri. Congratulations to and of course, Professor Ayaoki Agboki, for your contributions and for your participation also too. Also, but in my opinion, in conclusion, quickly conclusion, it's very important the relationship between 2030 African Union agenda and my city framework is very important point, because this base, this point is the way to become or to build in the practice our utopics. the agenda 2030 agenda in Africa with this particular point in Africa is the way for and the opportunity for resource, technology resource, for the financial resource, for the transformation, the real practice transformation of our cities. And we think now about African cities, but this is important too for European cities or in American cities, in Latin American and Caribbean cities too. And this dialogue, this dialogue of today is very important, because for me it's more clear the way to the transformation of the cities and the MIL University cities. Thank you so much, everybody. Thank you so much, dear Rachel Fischer. And my invitation for the book is a stand up. Thank you so much. But the final word is with the professor Emmanuel Emikonako. But everybody, can you speak, please?
Yes.
Here is an open space.
Yeah, it's an open space, Professor Felipe. Thank you very much for your support, for your contribution, for your leadership. I appreciate working together with you. Yes, Rachel, Dr. Veronica, Dr. Maha, Dr. Yauvi, you have the floor before you close the meeting.
If possible, I would like to add one thing. I think that MIL University Cities, it's very potential project, because as Professor Kunako, you told about the development of media and information literacy in school, in kindergarten, so on and so forth. But we must understand that university, in any case, there is the center of information in the city, and there is the hub of informational, educational media flows in the urban space. And in this case, I would like to say that this webinar must be the start point for the very big discussion about the opportunities of MIL University Cities, about the technologies, about the maybe new approaches to the pedagogical design of the progress about in the educational process, about what I told 2 days ago on the Congress, which Professor Chimbas Ortiz prepared. So I would like to say that this webinar, there is the start point, and it seems to me it's very potential project, of course. And I would like to also to add that when Professor Chimbas Ortiz talked about the book, the new book about MIL University Cities, it's very interesting suggestion, I would like to say. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Professor Veronica, for your contribution. Very appreciate. Yeah, Dr. Mara.
Just, you know, I think everybody more or less said everything, but I would like to say this about Rachel's presentation. We tend to be very jaded, very pessimistic about our future on the continent, but today you gave us hope. I am very sure that something is gonna come out of it, that it's gonna grow, that other universities in other parts of the continent are also gonna collaborate. We're gonna be hubs of knowledge. The university in Africa has a social responsibility, not to be an ivory tower, but the beacon for knowledge, and we need that. And since our youth are going to be statistically, we have the largest, we're going to have the largest number of young people on the globe, we really need to strive that they have a better future. For us, maybe because we're older or I'm older, maybe the time has passed for me, but I want this for my kids and I want this for my kids' kids. So thank you so much, Rachel.
Thank you, Dr. Maha, for your contribution. It is very appreciated. For your first time, you have added many things to our meeting. Thank you very much. Okay, Professor Agboke, do you have something to add before we close the door? Okay. He says he has nothing to share. It is very important to know it. So we are at the end of this exciting meeting. And on the behalf of Professor Felipe and our local team and everyone, to thank you for your contribution, for your engagement, for this work, for this project for Africa and for the whole world. We have hope that with you, we can build another Africa, another world where ethics, use of technology will be the base of the new development of human being. Thank you so much. We hope to meet you next time. Thank you and have a good day everywhere you are.
Thank you.
Bye.
Merci beaucoup.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you very much, Professor Felipe, Rachel, Veronica, Maha, ILV, and everyone where you are watching us, it is our joy to work together. Thank you. Have a nice day.
My words are the words of Professor. Thank you so much, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.